The scarcity mindset is an epidemic that is invading organizations across the world today, especially here. The key in choosing the right perspective is to recognize that during tough times, if you're not conscious about it, you will always choose scarcity. Scarcity is a script in your head. It becomes your reflex system. It becomes the starting point for how you react to change and how you get up every day and go to work. The scarcity mindset has a battle cry, and it's the following. There's not enough to go around. That's it. That's the starting point. Not much different than your dog. It believes there's not enough to go around. One way to think about it is I call it the little pie person complex. A little pie person believes that the pie of life is fixed, finite. And when a slice gets taken out, a slice has now gone away. In other words, they're win-lose. Zero-sum game. When you get it into your head, there is not enough to go around. That becomes your leadership paradigm, and you focus on survival of the fittest. You spend more time thinking about how much you dislike your competitors than you do trying to figure out how to improve the lives of the customers who are as bad or worse off than you are. When an organization comes down and is gripped with the scarcity mindset, they become little nuclear reactors instead of proactive innovators. They stop sitting around trying to figure out solutions for customer issues, and they start reacting. And every time something happens in the organization, it's always a gut check about me, isn't it? I can always tell this in an organization. When it comes down with scarcity, you can announce a reorganization, and every supposed leader in the organization has the first question. What is it? What does it do to me? What does this reorg mean to my resources? What does it mean to my profit and loss statement? And on a personal level, what does it mean to my job security? And they become reactive. You cannot react your way out of the new business environment. You will innovate your way out of it, just like we always have. You'll figure out a set of progressive solutions all the way from the beginning of the supply chain to the operator that gets the customer to have confidence again, brings more efficiency into the supply chain, and hopefully helps us all move this economy back forward. You don't get that in an environment of not enough to go around. All you get is a bunch of people trying to survive. And what I've learned is that you got to reconnect with your gratitude about the role that you have, the opportunity that you've been given, but most importantly, your teammates and your customers. And you need to go out and cherish your customers today because they are oxygen to you. Their dollars have never been more important to you. If your customer starts to complain that you're treating them transactionally, you've got your priorities wrong. And that's how weak-minded people behave during an economic downturn. What have you done for me lately? Nope. Grateful people are wonderful people. I love new hires. They're so cute when they're little, aren't they? I did new hire orientation at Yahoo. They're just so cute. Because a new hire like walks around all full of abundance and all full of gratefulness. They're like, oh, hey, coffee's free. They actually have milk. They get all excited. Milk. Not, and so they get excited. And they walk around saying, I just can't believe it. And then they always say the thing that kills me. They go, I can't believe they pay me to do this job. And then they lose their gratefulness, don't they? 2, 3, 4 years later, they become cynics, critics, and the yes, but gang. All they do now is talk about obstacles, things that shouldn't be. Here's an exercise you can do when you go home. NLP researchers say it will drive gratitude into your psyche. You take a piece of paper out, you write down 3 things you're grateful for in your role at your company, whatever it is. You're grateful for your mentors. You're grateful for the power of your brand. You're grateful for your reputation. You're grateful for your support staff. You're grateful for specific customers. You write down 3 things you're grateful for. You carry that around, and the next time that the mutters have taken you down, that's when you start talking to yourself. Starts when you make eye contact with yourself in the mirror. You take that piece of paper out, and NLP researchers say your handwriting will confront you with your gratefulness. The other thing you got to do as leaders, you got to clean house. I mean, it sounds tough-minded, but you know what? Chicken Little must fry. You want to change the conversation at work? Confront the next Chicken Little and tell them they aren't adding value and ask them where they come from. Another one of the adults they brought into Yahoo was the former president of Reader's Digest, Greg Coleman. He'd been there for over 20 years, ran their sales organization for over a decade. He said when he came to Yahoo at the end of 2003, he felt like he was part of an Outward Bound project. He said the CCCYA gang came out in full force and just thought he might want to know about everything. He said at one point he got so tired of the negative chatter, he went out and had a self-inking red stamp made. In big letters, it had two words, Chicken Little. He had his admin print out every single email from a repeat offender. And he stamped Chicken Little on it. And he had her posted on the wall of shame. According to the facilities group, technically the term for the wall of shame is the front lobby. He created a counterculture inside the organization. The counterculture said scarcity-minded people are weak. They should never be trusted to manage other people, and they hurt the power of our brand for the next decade. See, culture is the way things are done around here. That's what culture is, and leaders define culture. They define it with what they say, they define it with what they enforce, and they create an intuition. So when the leader's not around, people know how to think and how to behave. So you may need to clean house. Generosity will rewire you, because gloom and doom messages have rewired you for the worse. I hope I've made that point to you. It's rewired the way we think. It's rewired our inner dialogue. Will not make us effective. Generosity will undo all of this. You can't stop giving to efforts at your company around community development, sustainability, taking care of the quality of lives of employees, because when you make that investment, you teach yourself that scarcity is in your mind. If you don't think you have enough time, I challenge you to take on a mentee this year and grow her or him. If you think there's not enough resources to go around, I challenge you to volunteer and lend some of your precious headcount to another group in crisis inside your organization, and it'll teach you you got enough people to go around, because business will still be conducted. Over and over again, I hear stories of people who survived and thrived after the Great Depression based on their generosity at the bottom. Because strangers in a strange land pull themselves out through the compassion. Turn it off and get some sleep. Did you know that sleep deprivation is one of the biggest drivers of panic and fear in the psychological mindset at work? You know, we've had depressions and recessions before, but we've never had one where we had a crackberry set to stun on our waist. I am so glad it took a long time to get to a computer and get online in 2001. I would have gone crazy if I was a crackberry addict during that time. See, we put ourselves in a spin cycle, don't we? Did you know email rises about 40%? Reply to all doubles during tough economic times? Because you know what? We are fearless behind email. We are as fearless behind email as my toy poodle is behind a plate glass window. And we don't turn it off. And if you check email after you go home at night, you're going to kill yourself sleeping. And if you write emails evenings and weekends, you are sipping and sending, just admit it. Sipping and sending is the corporate equivalent of drinking and dialing. We do it because there's not enough time to go around. I see a lot of drinking and dialing in first class, but I digress. Here's the point. You need to turn it off and get some sleep. Because otherwise, you're going to lay in bed and do night math. I see it all the time. I do it all the time. That's when you got so much information, you're checking email right before you go to bed. What do? You lay there at night and you do math, don't you? You look at that LED clock next to your head and you start to do the following exquisite calculations. You say, it is 1:03 in the a.m. If I fall asleep in the next 12 minutes, I will still get 4 hours and 45 minutes of sleep. You do that, don't you? Okay. So,